chapter 1, verse 1, in the beginning. And our lesson last week was talking about wisdom in the beginning, how God, that's in Proverbs 8:22, God in the beginning, wisdom was by God to create everything that God created. Wisdom was there. Wisdom was there before the world was created, before earth was created. And that's in Genesis 1 and 1. Then we jump into authors talking about the beginning. You jump to the book of St. John, which is where our lesson will be today, 1:1. Talking about the beginning again. And then you follow that same author into his letters, his other letters, back in the Bible, 1 John 1, chapter 1, verse 1 again, he said, that which was from the beginning. So it's that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled, of the word of life. For the life was manifested, we seen it, bear witness, and show unto you that eternal life which was with the Father, that was manifested unto us. A very key word in those two paragraphs I'll say is witness. We are witness. We are the witnesses. And a witness is someone who has first-hand, direct experience with what we're talking about. So John was a witness. And in our lesson today, St. John, we might jump back over here to 1 John a little bit later, but let's go back to our lesson of St. John. Throw out a Greek word to us today and see if we can get a definition out of that meaning, because our whole lesson centers around it. The Greek word is logos. I wonder if Sister Sylvia, she's got Hebrew in her, don't she? It's a Greek word, though. Maybe from the Greek, real Greek. logos of God. You ever heard of that, Sister Sylvia?
I've heard of it.
The logos. I mean, you've heard of the rhema? Okay. You can distinguish.
Logos is the written word.
Logos is the what?
Written word.
Logos is the written word.
Rhema
is the spoken word. Rhema, that's why we have a college out here. Rhema Bible College, which just teaches preachers and those in the ministry how to execute the spoken word. That's rhema, the spoken word. You hear me preaching. You hear someone preaching, expounding, declaring the word of God in verbal. Now we're going to look at today's writing, which is more intimate, the logos, which is the written word, and it deals with what part of us. The logos, the written word, deals with our reasoning. The logos is look at this and reason it out. Reason it out. Logos will affect your conscience. It deals with your conscience. It deals with your heart. Hebrews 4 and 12 again talks again about that logos. Hebrews 4 and 12 is talking about help us out with some understanding in there. Let's see. Hebrews 4 and 12. Hebrews 4 and 12, it says, for the word of God is quick. The word of God is quick. So if it's spoken, it's quick. If it's even in the written form, it's alive still. It's quick still. So the word of God is quick. It's a living thing. It's a living reality. Powerful and sharper capability. Powerful, sharper means it has capabilities than any two-edged sword. Person, even into the dividing asunder, so this is where the logos and the rhema would go, soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow, that's the physical man, and is a discerner, it can judge the thoughts of your hearts, the thought and the intent of your heart. Neither is there any creature that is not manifest. It's not obvious in his sight. all things are naked and open unto the eyes of him with whom, and it says we have to do in King James, but in whom we have to account to, whom we have to reckon with, whom we have to give an account for. I mean, whom we have to reckon with. Reckon with means I have to give an account for my thoughts, my actions. I have to give them to the Word of God. So that takes out anybody in between. There is no middleman, no middle entity between us and the Word. Whatever your thoughts or intents of your heart is, you have to deal directly. You are dealing directly with the Word of God. So, and then it goes on down through, I think that last verse talks about prayer. You're going to pray, you want to be bold enough to stand in front, or deal with, reckon with, negotiate with, petition with the living, the Word. Then that's when you're dealing with you and God. You think there's somebody else between you and God that can soften up the situation, help out? Not really. It's you in the reality of God the Father, you and the Word. So. That's why I always tell folks, get in the Word, listen to the Word, know the Word, because that's whom you are dealing with. And now we're going to get a better identity in the book of St. John as who the Word is, who he says he is, but that's who you're dealing with. And when we're witnessing, helping out people, doing discipleship, you tell them plainly, that's you and God. You got to get with you and God, you know. That's you and God. But then motherfuckers, you know, okay, you know, yeah. So, John is bringing it home, the Word. And why he said the Word is because in the Greek, back in the day when he wrote, Greeks were philosophers. They did a lot of thinking. They did a lot of reasoning. He had to appeal to them through their reasoning mind, the conscious mind. That's how he had to appeal to them to bring it out to them. All right, now see how he brought it out to the Jew. We'll see there too. All right, St. John 1 and 1. It's going to say to us in John's first 14, 15 verses of St. John, he's bringing it out to us that God is manifested in the flesh. And then God was manifested in the flesh. And then let's see how man responded to the Word becoming flesh. There was a response to the Word becoming flesh. That was a response. I got all kind of scriptures running through my head right now dealing with how do we respond to the Word becoming flesh. My favorite portion of all the Bible, if anybody ever read that word, it would have to be Isaiah. What chapter? 53. I like Proverbs, the third chapter. I found a verse in there I like. But when I got full of the Holy Ghost and really got a glimpse and understanding of God, Isaiah 53, I can read that and I'm all right for the day. So, and Isaiah 53 tells us that basically the Word of God, the Word been made flesh, God been made in the flesh, he was rejected. He was despised. Probably verse 6, somewhere in there, a man acquainted with grief. Anybody got that portion? A man acquainted with grief. Isaiah 53. Anybody got that? Wrong Bible, huh? 53:3. Isaiah 53:3. He is despised and rejected. A man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. And we hid his, we wore our faces from him. We act like we didn't know him. He was despised, and we didn't even esteem him. The verse before that, it says, there is no beauty that we should desire of him. So when the Word was made flesh, people didn't think that much about him. God, the creator of all things, his very own creation. Wow. His creation in the flesh didn't give him that much deal. So, now, let's see if we can deal with some things here. We'll jump first to just, I know it's part of our lesson, St. John 1 and 7. It's going to say that the when it talks to the word, when John is trying to express to the Jews that the word is Messiah. Messiah has come. Messiah has come. That's what he's trying to point out to the Jew. Messiah has come. And to the rest of us, he's trying to say, and look at St. John 1:19. And this is the record of John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" And he confessed and denied not, but confessed, "I am not the Messiah. I am not the Messiah." Okay, so verse 23, he says, "I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord, as said the prophet Elias." All right, so let's jump into our lesson. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. I had some people come over to my house yesterday, call them J-E-W, as I call them. You kind of twisted up on this. In the neighborhood yesterday, Travis, I should have called you, gave you a warning. We'll be knocking on your door soon.
They start coming to my house.
What's up? Thought I got rid of them at one time. They come by and they kind of twisted up on this. And the word. In the beginning was the word. And the word was with God. And the word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. So who is God? God is the Word. What is the Word? The Word is God. When did it exist? It's eternity. Eternity. So the Word. Now, when we get saved, what do we get? When we confess Jesus as our Lord and Savior, what do we get?
Born again.
You get born again, what did you get? Get eternal life, and eternal life is that thing that was from the beginning. Mm-hmm. Woo! Figure that out. When you get born again, you get the beginning. That thing was in the beginning, where God was in the beginning, that's what you get. Huh. Woo! Good. Some scripture get bringing it up. You thought you just started in 1950s. Most of us? No. All things, verse 3. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. Hallelujah. Okay. The world did not recognize him. The world, did, when it says the world did not recognize him, we're really pretty much saying, like over in that Isaiah we read, we're pretty much saying the world does not recognize its need for him. His creation does not recognize its need for him. Wow. Its creation. This week the sun did a fantastic thing. Everybody heard about that? It's part of God's creation. It's doing its thing. It's always throwing out those kind of light displays and all that. There once why throw something down here and see if it can get to us. Because you can't burn them up. Can't burn them up. Do your thing, but you can't burn earth. And sun and take a decoy and use it this way. So just doing its thing. Can't hurt earth. Alright, so man's need, the creation of God, does not see its need for God, which brings us to the fact that the creation of God has not been enlightened. It doesn't, when enlightened means illuminate. Is that the word? Illuminate. Bring me some, open me up. Give me some understanding as to why I need my Creator. So, that's where the problem with God's creation is right now, is that it is not enlightened. And we know the story behind that. The devil did all that, caused a problem. So, the Old Testament, God spoke to the Jews and he manifested himself to his Jewish people, to the Hebrew people, through, guess what? Words. Something had to speak. Pretty much a prophet. Something had to speak. Moses saw the burning bush, and God spoke out of the burning bush. God told Moses, go tell, so Moses had to go speak. So in the Old Testament, revelation of God came pretty much through somebody speaking, a spoken, a word. Now, it's rejected or received either from the prophets or through the law. In the Old Testament, you either rejected the law or you lived in the law as best you could, and you listened to a prophet, his word about God. All right. Now, the Logos is what we're going to find out today. The Logos is what we have to deal with, the written word. Here's your expression of God right here. It's in the Bible. It's an amazing thing. And it's rejected or received of men. It could be either way. Some people can going to reject it or receive it. That's how it is. It's the Logos. And what is it about? It gets to our reasoning. Reason this out. Now reason this out. Okay. Let me reason this. When I first read the Bible before I got saved, I could not, comprehend. It was like a bunch of things, right? How many read the Bible while you had a fifth next to you? Sure. Red light district. In the military. I wish Brother McClendon was here. They had little green Bibles. You might have seen those? The New Testament, something they call it. Yeah. Kept one in your pocket. You go out there in the village or whatever you were doing your thing. Some folks said, it saved my life. Bullet hit them. You ever heard that? Bullet hit the Bible and the soldier said, it saved my life. It was just something in there he didn't understand. It was just, I better carry it. Almost like a rabbit's foot. <Many did that. laughs> Lucky beast, you know. Didn't understand what it was in there. It's not enlightening me to anything, but anytime you peeped in there, it start dealing with your reasoning. Wow. It's too much. Close it up, put it up for another day. So every time you open up the Logos of God, it's dealing with your conscious man. Stealing with your heart, and it's throwing out some light. How much we are able to absorb is of another matter, but it's throwing out that light to us. Okay, here we go. Now, reasoning, Logos to reason, because it is the eternal word. Here we go. Now, let's look at some scriptures again. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was what? Made. Nothing made. That everything came because of him. In him, someone read verse 4, if you would help me out. God, let's kind of hit on that just a bit there.
In him was life, and the life was the light of men.
Okay, and the life was the light of men. There's two kinds of life that we're dealing with. There's human life, and there's eternal life. Now, human life gives... More human life. With that human life, you get the gift of reasoning. Let me reason this out. All right, but human reasoning is limited. So for human to get the full understanding, he needs eternal life. Life that comes from the beginning to really lighten up the issue. And that is called, that's where it says in verse 4, in him was life. And that eternal life is the light of men. Once you got saved, this Bible became very almost simple.
How I got it.
Once you got eternal life, once you got born again, that life kind of lit up the place for you, gave you understanding. But when you was in darkness and when you were not saved and you were just walking around with human life, you know, this human life, we didn't get the whole difference. Okay, put the little Bible in my pocket, carry it with me. I might need it out there. It might show me some stuff. Cecilia, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. Might help me out here while I'm out in the streets, you know? Every time you go to jail, they throw you what? Throw your Bible.
I know that.
You know that. Man, I wish I had a church. They give you a Bible on the bunk. That's a Bible. That's the easiest thing to get when you go to prison. It's a Bible. Go to the military. Go to the hotel room.
Yeah.
There it is. Why do you need a Bible in the hotel? I don't know. Might need some light. What I'm coming here for, I need a Bible. Well, you might need some light. Some understanding. So mankind knew that eternal life, the real answers, is right there. But human light is going to be just so limited. And here he says in verse 4, in him was life, and the life was the light of men. Okay. And the light shined where? And the darkness did what? Don't get it. Don't get it. Do not get it. Okay, that's how every one of us was at one time. So, because there's the beginning, there's eternity, and then you have human life that can't, they don't quite jive together. Eternal life from the beginning is trying to lighten up this guy down here who has limited understanding. The wisdom of God says, I'm going to use instruments, make man my instrument, to bring the light to the darkness. And God, he uses a man, humanity, his own creation, to lighten up what's going on down here. And his object, or his messenger, because we're talking word, messenger, was someone named whom?
John.
Same John that wrote this book?
No.
No, different John. Different John. John the Baptist. All right. Then came, the same came for a, verse 7, to be a what? A witness. A witness is first-hand direct experience. John the Baptist had first-hand experience with the Word, which is eternal life, which was from the beginning. That kind of gives us a clue how powerful John was. His work on earth, you must be the Messiah. You must be one of them prophets. As awesome and different, unique as you are, you have to be somebody sent from God at least. Who are you? John said, I'm not the Messiah. How about one of the prophets? I'm not one of them. Who are you? I'm just a man used of God, of the spoken word I'm using. That kind of gives us a clue as to how awesome you can be if we incorporate the what? Word into our life, into our everything. Because it's a living organ. It's a living entity. It's got life in it. It has the ability to create, divide stuff, move stuff, get into your body. What? Get into your body. Get into my body, yeah. And your mind. The word can say, I know what you're thinking. Hope can't hide that thought. You put on clothes to cover up my nakedness, but the word says, I see you. You got a birthmark on your right cheek. Been in my life. Word. You can't hide nothing from it. It knows. It's right there. That's what it says over in Hebrews. You can't hide nothing from him. You have to reckon with him. You have to negotiate. You have to petition. You have to realize he's right there with you. It's there. So if I really had that word, really have the word, eternal life, so close to me down here on earth, I should be making some tangible difference than ordinary. I want to get on that. I have to charge off that kind of preaching. But okay, that's okay. All right, there was a man sent from John to give us the Logos. The man sent from God who would give us the Logos, his name was John. Okay. The same came for a what? Witness. To bear witness of the light. How did John get so much, know so much, so short a time? I do not know. Verse 8 says, he was not that eternal life. He was not that light, but was sent to tell you about that light. How many, have anybody ever tried to explain eternal life? Let's take a run through the room. What is eternal life? Is that a fair question to ask a believer? What is eternal life?
Not even after this life. Yeah. In Christ Jesus.
Ah, okay.
What is eternal life? Just to live with Christ. Yeah. After this body is dead, you know, back to the, our spirit will rise again to the way eternal. Eternal is forever. I mean,
Okay.
Victory over sin and death.
Victory over sin and death. Hold that point.
The spirit get renewed.
It does. That's eternal life.
And you gain a new body.
Eventually, you get a growth.
Yeah, eventually. Okay. That'll last you know,
Okay.
Life after this life.
Life after this life. I wish I could put a check and an X. Sister Sylvia, my Hebrew student. What are y'all guys called?
I disagree with everybody else. I mean, life eternal.
Brother Rob, what did you say it was again?
Life after this life.
Life after this life. Eternal life. Life after this life. Don't want to pick on Ron, but how many agree with Ron? Yeah. Class, what is eternal life, Rod? He says life after this life. As a professor of theology,
it includes life after this
life. It deals life after this. I mean, you can. That is a feature, a benefit, a component of life after this life. Ah, that's probably where 80%, 90% of the Christian world get off track. Listen, he's got the right component. It is life after this life. But what about right now, Ron? What about now? When does eternal life kick in?
Born again.
When you're born again. Now, to be honest with ourselves, most Christians don't believe it. I don't realize that.
I think you're right.
You don't realize that. You got as much life, if you are a believer, as Sister said, in Jesus Christ, as you're going to get. Does it improve? Oh, you said as you go along, you should say, you know what? I can stretch my wings a little bit here. This stuff is pretty good. Eternal life. Now, when I first got saved, I was glad to be out of what? Hell. Good enough. But as I went on, I started saying, you know what? I didn't know that. Thinking is different. Believing, confidence, capabilities. I didn't know I could do that. Now all this kind of things. Why is that? Light. You're getting. I'm in a dark room. I can't. You know. I'm glad to be in a dark room in shelter. But as the more light comes on, I can find. You know, that's a nice couch over there. I don't have to stand up all the time. Oh, well, I'm not to sit. It's a bed. Flat screen TV. Football game. Wow. And you're moving through. You know how you're doing that long? Yeah. Ooh. Hit the popcorn machine from the couch. Everything is great. This is getting good. That's what you learn in social. You know, you start learning that I don't have to be a victim of sin. I don't have to be defeated by I think Kenya says it's victory over darkness. It's victory over sin. That's what eternal life is. But most folks don't realize that. My friends in the Baptist church can explain this better than anybody I know. They know born again. As far as living it out, that can you really have victory over sin? Yeah, you got victory over anything you want to have victory over with eternal life. Anything you want to experience, you can get the victory with eternal life. Now, we see that on all scales. You can't go to the moon. Yeah, I got light. I've been emulated. I've been enlightened. I've been instructed how to get there. Go to the moon. What a thought. Fly an airplane. Like a what? What? I mean, back in that day, who would be the first one to take the pilot test? First test. Any volunteers? I got this machine that'll show us how to fly. Who wants to go up with me? No.
I don't know
where I'm going. People are all around me. You know, not me. somebody else, you know. Not going to get me. Somebody else. So it gives you light. Eternal life enlightens you to what, ideals, capabilities, that with darkness you just don't think. Some people think, I can't even get victory over a pack of cigarettes. And just can't do it. But an eternal life gives you that light that says you got the victory over that stuff. Here's how you overcome that. Light. That's what light, that's what eternal life does. So you start taking, I'll say, advantage, start profiting by eternal life while you're on earth. I got to preach it because I have to charge up. Let's see. Okay. So John said, let me explain this light to you, this logos, this word to you. Let me tell you what the word was. Verse 6, it was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that eternal life. That was verse 8. Verse 9, that was the true light, which lighted what?
Every man.
That cometh into the world. Now, every man comes into the world with some reasoning ability. That's human ability. Get that from your mom and your daddy, you know, and your grandkids get it from, they just keep passing on down the line, some human reasoning abilities. But there's a higher order for your faculties to deal with. And that's why it's written, so it's in written form so that you can reason it out. Again, Hebrews 4 and 12. It's discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Discerner. Okay, that's what he does. That was the true life, like every man that cometh into the world. Now, let's look at Hebrews 4 and 12 real quick, one more time. Well, let's, while we're going back to the Hebrews, let's go to 1 John. 1 John, chapter 1, verse 1. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, hands have handled, of the word of life. The life was manifested. We seen it and bear witness, showing to you that eternal life that was with the Father and was manifested unto us. See, that eternal life existed, and once you get it, you got it. I got all the life that the Father has. Oh, man, that was a revelation to me. I got as much life once I accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior as the Father has. It's called eternal life. That which was seen, declared we unto you, that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. These things, how is it expressed to us? Written. It's written unto you. I'm in logos form. The written form, so that you may, these things write we unto you, that your joy might be what? Full. But see, now you have to write the word to, it's better in written form because people come from different backgrounds. You know, you get people from Africa that believes in don't kill a cow because it's sacred. India, somewhere like that. India, don't kill a cow because it's somebody, somehow. But I'm starving to death, but I'm going to let that cow walk by. And then, so I have to, you know, just talking to that person won't get it. I got to put it down in front of him in a form that he can read it and ponder it and reason it out. The man that says, anybody ever overcome anything? Drugs, cigarettes, any type of sin, anything. Did you overcome it by someone preaching to you or by you looking at that word and says, that makes sense what he says. I see this here. How did it happen?
It had to be by reading. Because only God can, or Jesus can change you themselves. Hearing someone can't change you. You have to read it and absorb it for yourself,
right,
and internalize it.
That's right. See, the preacher is
the door for you, but
yeah, the preacher is like John the Baptist.
Yeah.
Here's the message, but John the Baptist, I got to put it down in writing so you can reason. In the book of Acts, it says that when they heard the preaching, they went home and they looked at the written word to see if this stuff made sense. Acts. I don't know. What does 14 and 17 say in the book of Acts? I might be totally wrong, but that could be somewhere in there. But this might be on a different course. We should read this in. Well, it says that they preach the gospel. They preach the gospel. But it's another place they reason it out. They went home and searched and see if these things were so. So if you're going to look up a word, say, it searched the scriptures. I went home and searched the scriptures to see if these things were so. Now, that brings me to another point here. If, like Travis said, that the preacher is preaching it, and I hear it, but I got to get somewhere where I can, you know, for me to change and change, you got to hit me real good. So I gotta sit down and reason out the word. That's what the locust does. Now some people will say that, okay, I ain't never read nothing. I ain't opened up a Bible in my life. Anybody know anybody like that?
Yeah.
I ain't got no Bible or got nothing. So I am without I can you can't get me because the word has never been, what was that, Candy?
Acts 17:11
says that they went home and searched the scriptures to see if these things were so, something of that nature.
The ones that were more noble, did.
Huh?
Yeah, the ones that were more noble.
The ones that were more noble, that was really trying to get understanding, went home and see if these things were so. They searched it out. They searched the written word.
And that they received the word with all readiness of mind and searched the scriptures daily. Whether those things were so.
To search the scriptures daily to see if, and that's the locus. They search the locus, the written word. Now, the guy that says, I ain't seen nothing, I ain't read nothing, so therefore, I'm innocent. You can't put nothing on me because I ain't never dealt with the word. And some people think that if I don't go to church, I'll go into a church and get in there, then I'm okay because, you know, you can't put that on me. You know, hey, I don't know. Hey, you can't get me for what I don't know. Is that really true?
No. I got it.
Romans 1, verse 19. Well, I ain't never seen nobody. Let's see. Romans 19. Somebody says, I don't know nothing about God. Really? Okay, now here we go. Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them. For God had showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him, from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. See, creation shows you there is a God. There is a Godhead. There's a powerful God. What you got, Candy?
John 3:18-19 says they were condemned. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation, that light is come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil.
Because their deeds were evil, right. Now, and here he says that just man is without excuse. From the creation, God shows that he exists.